it's definitely an important play. And in much of the world, outdoor air quality is in fact getting better. At the same time, indoor air quality is probably getting worse, maybe staying the same, depending on particular context. But we've got a real issue. And this is acknowledged. This is quite out of date now, because this is the last time the EPA did this. But it used to be every few years they would come out with the greatest environmental health risks for Americans. And you can see that the four of the top five are either wholly or partially indoor-related issues. And they stopped producing this list for a variety of reasons. But one of them was that the thing that is the greatest environmental risk is the thing that the EPA has no mandate to regulate. And so we're in this kind of weird region of something that can't be regulated, but it is very important to our health. And you know, we've known about poor indoor air quality for a long, long time. And we've even known how to deal with it. It's basically a three-pronged strategy. You get rid of sources, you ventilate with outdoor air that's cleaner, and you use filtration and air cleaning to take care of the rest. And you know, this is not new knowledge. You know, there was even in the Bible there was mention of some things about indoor air quality. So this is not new knowledge, and you know, there's a hierarchy here too. You get rid of sources first, then you ventilate, then you use filtration. Now there's problems, of course. If we start with source control, there are some sources that are very hard to deal with. Cooking is a classic example. Cooking is an enormous generator of pollutants. It's one of the leading causes of sickness and death globally, especially cooking over solid fuels. And so, you know, you can't have people not cooking. There's also lots of sources we don't know much about. These are some data that we took as part of a study on something completely different. This is from a condo in downtown Toronto. These are measurements of PM2.5, the low-cost monitor. And the blue line is the median PM2.5 concentration in this condominium over the course of a year. So a lot of measurements. And there's this huge spike at midnight. And it turns out that the occupant of this apartment uses an essential oil diffuser. If you don't know what an essential oil diffuser is, it's essentially a very small ultrasonic humidifier. You put some water in it, you put some essential oil in it, and you get a nice aroma throughout your home. And it turns out it generates a ton of particles. I mean, this is really an amazing particle generator. And I'm going to come back to essential oil diffusers a little bit later in the talk. But it's a perfect example of a source that's essentially completely undescribed in the literature. And, okay, so we can't always deal with sources, we don't always know about them. What about ventilation? Well, I'm going to suggest that ventilation is a little bit overstating the fact, but it's dead. And it's dead because when outdoor air is very poor, obviously ventilation doesn't work by itself. And we have increasingly places in the world with very poor outdoor air quality. Even though it is getting better on average. And not only that, even in relatively clean environments, we have people who live near major roadways and who are exposed to outdoor air pollution some times of the day or some parts of the year. So that leaves us with filtration and air cleaning. And this is a summary of studies that have taken place over the past decade or so that have looked at the benefit-to-cost ratio. That's what's shown on the y-axis. As a for particle filtration. And the x-axis here is different efficiencies of filters. There's four studies represented here. They all made different assumptions, looked at different buildings. Some of them looked at commercial, some of them looked at residential buildings. They made a variety of different kind of approaches to the problem, but there's surprisingly kind of coincidence in the results that we see benefit-to-cost ratios that range from 10 to 100. So this is an enormously obvious place for investment. Very large benefit-to-cost ratios. But I mean, to give away a substantial part of what I'm going to talk about next, we don't see very much investment in filtration and air cleaning. For example, the filters for this building, if assuming they're like the rest of the University of Toronto, are filters that essentially do nothing for our health. They protect the equipment from big pieces of dust. So why are we seeing this investment? And I think those health benefits are real. They're obviously very large, but they're chronic health benefits largely. And they impact people decades in the future. And we know from a variety of other public health problems, it's very hard to get people motivated about things that occur decades in the future. Not only that, not to be too crass and talk about monetization, but I'm going to a few times in this talk, it's really hard to get people to pay for those health savings or those health benefits when people are in many different buildings over the course of their lives, over the course of their day. And so any investment in any one building is very hard to trace back to an eventual health benefit. And then there's this issue of who's paying the cost and who's receiving the benefits. So I'm going to suggest that we need a completely different model to deal with indoor air quality. And to kind of point towards this model, I'm going to point towards an article that has gotten a lot of attention in the media in particular. Came out a few years ago. It's by Usha Sapiech and her colleagues. And what they did is they looked at what's called decision-making or higher-level cognitive function in the presence of different levels of carbon dioxide concentrations. And what you see here along the x-axis are different aspects of the cognitive function test that they use. And you can see that the darker circles, which represent higher carbon dioxide concentrations, but I would point out not that high, but still elevated carbon dioxide concentrations, you see in many of these areas diminished cognitive performance. And so this is suggesting that we have cognitive impacts that people actually care about from exposures, at least to CO2. Now, I have a lot of issues with the general finding. It turns out there's about 30 papers in the literature that have looked at the impact of CO2. And Bo and Du, one of my graduate students who's here, talked to him. He's doing a review of that literature. But I think that leaving aside the issue of whether carbon dioxide impacts cognitive function, there's something really important going on here. And what's going on here is that exposures do impact cognitive function. And those exposures represent a huge opportunity for us in indoor air because, first of all, it's an acute impact. The time scale for most impact from exposures is on the time scale of seconds and minutes before it can be detected. And so you can take action right away. And then the second thing is that cognitive function is much easier to monetize than health effects decades in the future. People are willing to pay for it, particularly in some environments. Office buildings and schools are good examples of that. So the kind of model that I'd like to propose is that we invest in indoor air quality to improve cognitive function, and we use the benefits from that cognitive function to pay for the investment. And we don't even talk about the chronic health outcomes. We get those as a side effect. And this model has a fair amount of basis, particularly for people who did energy conservation. They did the exact same thing about 20 years ago. They started selling energy conservation in terms of quieter buildings, smaller systems, more comfortable indoor environments, and didn't mention the energy savings. And that turned out to be quite beneficial. So in order for this model, we have to kind of understand it a little bit more. So I'm collaborating here with Michael Mack, who's a professor here in psychology. And what we're doing is we are exposing subjects to different indoor pollutants and imaging their brains at the same time while they're doing cognitive function tasks. And so our idea here, or Mike's idea here, is that we can build a neurocognitive model of exposure, actually understand what's happening in the brain as a result of these exposures. And I'm just very briefly going to show you, we did a very simple experiment. About 40 test subjects, we exposed them to emissions from an essential oil diffuser. In some cases, the essential oil diffuser had essential oil in it, in some cases it didn't. In some cases, we were scrubbing selectively the particle compounds from the air with a HEPA filter. And these results would take a long time to go into detail, but the basic answer here is that subjects who are exposed to essential oil diffuser emissions made decisions that were consistent with being more impulsive. This is a finding that turns out you can find hints of it in the literature from, have you ever noticed when you go into some stores, the there's a scent being put in the air. I don't have direct evidence of this, but there is some evidence that that's done to make people more impulsive, which is exactly what you want when people are shopping. So this is consistent with some aspects of the literature. And so, you know, I think that this raises all kinds of issues. One is that in the history of indoor air, we've largely focused on reducing concentrations of things. And this might suggest that in some cases, we might want to increase exposure. So for example, one aspect of impulsiveness sometimes is that people make faster decisions, which can be desired. We may be increasing exposures, or we may be trading off different aspects of things that I don't really think we can trade off. Different or improved cognitive function, perhaps with chronic health benefits. And of course, what this conference is about, sensors, there's going to be a huge component of monitoring here. And just to wrap up here, I want to make some comments about monitoring. So first of all, low-cost indoor monitoring is really becoming ubiquitous. There's smart thermostats, connected smoke alarms and CO monitors. A lot of air cleaners have pollutant sensors on them these days. And so that data is out there. And it tells an enormous amount about people. And so as an example, this group of researchers, Randy Chan and her colleagues, they monitored a bunch of apartments and were able to tell, just from a particle concentration measurement, what sources were active at different times in the home. So we know whether you're smoking, how many cigarettes you're smoking, how active you are, other types of sources you have present, are your windows open? There's a whole host of things going on, only some of which are actively being done, as far as I know, but there's a lot of potential for knowing a lot about people from these pollutant concentrations. And we're starting just at the tip of seeing, for example, artificial intelligence and machine learning used to kind of understand what's happening in people's homes from these connected devices. And that's something I think this community needs to pay a lot of attention to. So, you know, the big picture summary here, indoor air is important, and it's kind of neglected in the broader air pollution community. We see some very large health impacts from exposures in indoor air, but we don't see a lot of response to those health impacts and the changes in behavior, and certainly not in policy. And so we need to think about alternative models. I think cognitive function is one piece of that, but I think that there's a variety of other models that we need to consider. And I'll finish there. Thank you. Amazingly kind of polluted environments from an